With this, we start our second session, which is about relational models and an introduction to databases. First, we look at the relational model. We'll have a very brief introduction to relational algebra, which is the theoretical foundation. In the process, we'll also introduce to structured query language, the programming language which is used mainly for database, which is what you are going to then practice over the next 5 days. The relational model was developed by Professor Cord, as I mentioned earlier, and this formed the basis of a great research work at IBM in System R. System R was relational system. Before that, the databases which existed, which were defined by CODASIL. CODASIL is the Committee on Data System Languages, which defines these databases. The same committee actually defined many standards related to business information processing. COBOL programming language. How many of you know the origin of COBOL programming language? This curiously came as a committee defined standard. There did not exist any COBOL. The first programming language to come in this world, higher level language, was Fortran that appeared in 1956. But it was found to be inadequate for solving many of the problems related to data processing. So a committee was appointed to study and define a programming language. Then that committee was taking a very long time. So it was renamed as long-term committee. And a short-term committee was appointed to come up with specification of a programming language which could be used in the interim till the long-term committee works. There's a lady from United States Navy who headed that committee. The Department of Defense in United States used to be the purchaser of 50% of all computers manufactured in the world. So they were major users. So they formed the chairperson was that lady, and there was a group. And it was a very curious discussion. They defined all the features that you see them even today, like sort feature, this, that, all they defined. On the last day, when they were concluding that report, somebody said, we have not yet come up with a name for the language. And some names were doing the round. One of the younger participants said, how does it matter? This whole language that we are defining will stay alive only for 2 or 3 years, because the long range committee is going to define things later. So the names which were being discussed were COSIL, COCOSIL, etc., rhyming on CODASIL, which was the committee. He suggested COBOL as Common Business Oriented Language. This name was never discussed in that committee till that point, and it was discussed exactly for 5 minutes with the rationale that anyway this name and the language is going to die because the long range committee will actually work late. So they submitted the report. The report was so appreciated that the long range committee said, we have no more work to do. And they wound themselves up. That's how COBOL has stuck with us all our lives. So there are funny things that happen in the history of development. Databases came much later. As I said, the network databases and the hierarchical databases were essentially an improvement on navigating associated records in a large file system. But many features of the databases, like this atomicity of transactions, or like the concurrency control, like the recovery, they were actually made part of the database. The notion of schema was already developed. But the relational model came out of this work quite independent. So Professor Cord is actually the creator of this model. And the System R, which resulted in DB2, the database 2 of IBM mainframe, which is now available on Unix and other systems, that was the world's first major commercial database. Simultaneously, Ingress was the world's first database which was born in the university environment. The PostgreSQL which you are going to use is actually a outgrowth of the Ingress database management. There is mathematical foundation for database modeling. There is a relational algebra and relational calculus, of which we are going to briefly look at relational algebra. And the most important part, the structured query language. Originally, it was called structured English-like query language and was termed SQL. SEQUEL. When the databases became international standards, the name changed to SQL, but it is still pronounced as SQL in honor of the original name SQL. A relational model merely formalizes something that we have briefly discussed in the previous set. You remember those sets of students and sets of courses and the association sets that we drew? Imagine that each set is a mathematical entity. Based on that fact that each set can be regarded as a mathematical entity comprising of elements of a set, and mathematical operations can be defined on these sets, came out the relational algebra or the relational theory that Professor Kaur proposed. He defined a set, a relation to be a set of n tuples. So what is an n tuple? It's a new name for many of you. You probably know a couple. Couple means what? Two values. Triple means what? Three values. Quadruple means what? Four values. So if some entity has two attributes, we say it has couple of attributes. Some entity has three attributes, it is a triple attribute, quadruple attributes. N tuple means n attributes. So n tuple is nothing but something rhyming on double, triple, quadruple, okay, and therefore they name n tuple. So n tuple is nothing but a set of n values which represent an entity. So for example, if a student is represented by roll number, name, hostel number, room number, and performance. So these are five attributes. Then we say there is a five tuple which represents one student. How many n tuples will be there in the set? As many as there are students. If there are 5,000 students, there are 5,000 n tuples. If there are 300 courses, there are 300 n tuples. If the reg set, has n tuple is what? Roll number, course code, and grade. So it's a three tuple. And how many such three tuples will be there describing the reg? 30,000 maybe. The number is not important. What is important is each element of the set is unique. And each element comprises of n tuples. These correspond directly to rows in a table as we have seen. Further, each relation has a schema. What is the schema? Effectively, it is nothing but every entry for that file. Except that it is guaranteed that there is no occurs clause. All values are single valued attributes, and there is a primary key associated with the table or file. So this is similar to column headers in a table or FD entries in a COBOL file. Conceptually, there is not much different. The fundamental conceptual difference is in treating these entities as sets, mathematical sets, because that is what gives rise to very powerful paradigms of expressions which result in SQL later. Here is a sample relation schema. Student, S role, S name, S hostel, S room, S CPI. Course, course code, C code, course name, course credits. Reg, S role, C code, grade. You're all familiar with this? So this is the schema of the relation. The actual, so this is schema is nothing but metadata. The actual relation is those 5,000 tuples in the schema for student, 300 tuples within the schema of course, and maybe 30,000 tuples in the schema for reg. That is the actual data. So a relation is the actual data. Relation schema is metadata. This much is clear and greatly similar to our concept of files. Now the fun starts. So here is a student relation which is looked as a set. What is important is to imagine this not as a file of individual records, but as a mathematical set. So this is a mathematical set. The number of elements in this set is equal to number of students. And each element in the set is a five tuple if the student has five attributes. Similarly, there will be a course set and there will be a reg set. A student relation as a table can be seen like this. So every row is a n tuple or a five tuple. So this is one element, this is second element, third element, fourth element, as many elements. The relational algebra is nothing but a mathematical algebraic foundation where each relation is treated as an element and operators are defined over relations. So mathematically, an operator is what? Consider an addition operation. Addition is defined over a set of integers, let's say. And 3 plus 2 is 5. 5 is also an integer. An important part of the mathematical operations of this type is that whenever an operator operates upon elements, the result is an element of the same type, the same set. Okay. So it remains in the same boundary of the overall mathematical structure. As we shall see, it may not be an element of this set or that set. It may be an element of another set because a new schema may get defined in the process. but it's still an element which can be treated exactly like an element of any other set in this mathematical structure. A relational operation results in a new relation. In terms of our table definition or file definition, we can consider this to mean that it may result in a table with different set of rows, but with the same schema. It may result in a different schema, but with the same set of rows. Or it may result in both, but it will still be an n tuple of some schema of some relation. Now, this simple and elegant mathematical structuring permits us to derive immense value in terms of our power of expression to extract information out of these sets, as we shall see in a moment. First of all, we discuss the notion of keys. We discuss it briefly here, we will discuss it more formally later. We are all familiar with primary key, but let's consider the nomenclature that is used. One is called super key, the next is called candidate key, and the third is called primary key. So let's see what these animals are. Super key is a set of attributes that uniquely characterizes a specific n tuple in a set. So any combination of attributes whose values uniquely characterize a particular tuple is a super key. If you take all possible super keys and try to see which is a minimal super key, that means if you remove one of the attributes from the set of attributes, the remaining thing is still a candidate, is still a super key, then the original was not minimal. This one is minimal. You keep breaking it like that. When you get a minimal value, then you say that is a candidate key. There could still be multiple candidate keys, each one of which is minimal in this sense. Then out of those candidate keys, we choose a particular key depending upon practicalities. That particular choice is called the primary key. So primary key is nothing but a chosen candidate key. Let's examine this in the context of our sets. Student has S role, S name, SH, SR, SCPR. So which are the super keys, which are the unique identifiers? S role is apparently unique. S role plus S name is also unique. In fact, S role plus S name plus SH, everything, S role plus anything is unique. So please note that there are many possible super keys. If we assume that every student lives in a single room which is allocated to every student, then as we saw, SH plus SR is also a super key, hostel and room number. SH plus SR plus S role is also a super key. SH plus SR plus name is also a super key. So there are large number of super keys which are possible. Which are the candidate keys? Candidate keys are reduced minimal super keys. So for example, S role plus S name is a super key. If I remove S role and S name separately, is S name a super key? No, but S role is. Since S role is a super key, S role plus S name cannot be a candidate key because it is not minimal. All such minimum super keys are candidate keys. It is very obvious in this example that S role and SH plus SR are the two candidate keys. Out of these two candidate keys, I have to choose one. As we discussed briefly, it makes eminent sense to choose this artificial number S role as the primary key. Therefore, primary key is S role. In a nutshell then, we may have many super keys. A super key is nothing but a combination of attributes whose value uniquely identifies a tuple. Out of all those super keys, we find out minimal super keys, they constitute the set of candidate keys. And out of multiple candidate keys, we may choose any one to represent unique identifier for that entity, which becomes then, or unique, we will not talk of entities now, these are elements, mathematical elements, uniquely identifying element, then we call it a primary key. You myself, identify yourself.
Myself, Vimlesh Kumar.
Yeah.
Basically, this means that all possible combinations of attributes which can act as a primary key are candidate keys.
Must be.
Candidate keys can have a field which where null value can be applicable?
No.
Never?
No super key can have an attribute which can be nullable. What will happen is that if there are null values, then there is no uniqueness that you can guarantee.
No, because that is a combination of fields.
Correct. Suppose there are five attributes forming a super key. Fifth attribute can be null value. Imagine two elements which have the same value for the first four attributes. And for the fifth attribute, both of them have null value at an instance of time. Then you cannot uniquely associate any one of these with one particular element. In fact, in the entire discussion on keys, this is a very important point that he is making, in the entire description of keys, we should never have an attribute which is a null valuable attribute as a part of the key, because we will lose the important feature of the key, namely guaranteed unique identification of an element. So therefore, null values or null valuable attributes should not be part of this. You are very right. So, for example, CPI, which could be a null value, okay. Of course, CPI will never occur alone, or CPI will never occur in combination of other things in this particular example, but you are very right, there should be no null valuable attribute. So, super key, candidate key, and primary key is clear. Later on, we will have a more mathematical definition of this. Here is a sample relation, S role, S name, SH, SR, SCPI. This relation is shown as a table. A table intuitively all of us consider to be a file. There is one important difference between a relation and a file or a table. For example, suppose a new student joins in, and suppose you have a file in COBOL. What will you do? You will insert that student in that file. The original file remains as that file. If you call that file as student file, then the student file remains. Mathematically, however, when you insert a new student in a relation, you get a new relation. The original relation had so many rows, the new relation has so many plus one, the relation is different. Mathematically, these two relations are not same. So you'll have to call it student and student one. This is very, very important to appreciate that mathematically, a relation where even a small change occurs anywhere is not same as the original relation. That is why when you say operation, operation will always produce a new relation. Here is a sample relation where SCPI is shown here. Consider this. Vijay Amre, Parag Samarth, Arul Menezes, Ajay Shah, Rajan Tambe. This is from the previous slide. Here, I have Sanjay Mistry, Vijay Amre, Shaukat Ali, Arul Menezes, Ajay Shah. You see one row has been added here. So this is a new relation. Consider that Sanjay Mistry is deleted and Rajan Tambe's CPI is changed to 7.25. For us as COBOL programmers, this is the same file where the values have been updated. That is what indeed happens even with database schema tables. But mathematically, this is a different relation. It has different set of attribute values, therefore it's a different relation. This is just important to conceptually understand the mathematical model. Otherwise, in practice, we are not going to have, every time something changes, you are not going to have a different file. But mathematically, it's a different entity. As long as we recognize that, that's okay. In practice, it does not affect because such updates or inserts do not change the schema of the relation at all. The schema remains the same. So therefore, the mathematical structure also remains the same. If any value in a table or a file changes because of add, delete, or update, such a change can be made in the same table or file. However, a relational operation results in a new relation. This is the conceptual difference I was talking about. Relational algebra operations are used to extract meaningful information from one or more relations. That is the importance of relational algebra. We shall see relational algebra operations, and we shall see for each operation a corresponding SQL query to which a relational algebra operation can be directly mapped. And that is what gives the power of expression to anybody who is trying to extract information out of such tables. So we shall briefly see that. What are the relational algebra operators? There are four operators. This is a new terminology for many of you, so you might want to pay special attention to the mathematical aspect. Selection. In plain English, it means get rows from a relation. So if your set or relation has 5,000 students, then you want to select some 200 students. On what basis would you select? That basis is called the selection predicate or the condition on which you want to select rows. But the operator mathematically is called a selection operation. Projection is to get columns from a relation. Let's say you have roll number, name, CPI, hostel number, etc., etc. You just want roll number and names. Now, when you want just roll numbers and names, you want two of the column values out of that entire table of five columns, then you are extracting columns from a relation. Here again, there is some condition. What is that condition? You give the list of attributes which you want to be extracted out. That operation is called projection. Projection term, those of you who have done some engineering drawing would remember. Or anyway, if you have a three-dimensional entity, you keep it in the sun, the shadow is two-dimensional. So the shadow is the projection of that original thing. It's like this. You have a five-dimensional or ten-dimensional entity in a relation. Some dimensions you project, and that's why it's called a projection. Cross product is another mathematical term which is very easy to understand. It simply combines rows from multiple tables. For example, student table has 5,000 rows. Course table has 300 rows. What are the total possible rows that you can make out of a combination of these two tables? 5,000 into 300. That is called a cross product. A cross product simply results in number of elements which is equal to the product of individual number of elements. And the way the final schema of the cross product is defined is very simple. You concatenate the schema of one and schema of another. The totality is the schema of the cross product. And the number of elements in that is, you take one element from one table, concatenate one element from second table, that is one row. First element of first table, second row of second table, that is second row, and so on. That's how you get 5,000 into 300 rows in that concatenated table, which is called a cross product. Clearly, the cross product table that so results, or relation so results, is highly unlikely to be useful at all. It will have millions of rows which will contain some kind of rubbish information. But cross product is the only fundamental operation in relational algebra if you want to extract information from more than one table. From a single table, if you want to extract information, you have selection and projection operation. And you can obviously combine them. But if you want to extract information from multiple tables, then cross product is the only fundamental operation. Since cross product does not result directly into any meaningful information, you apply further selection and projection onto that cross table to extract only the meaningful information. And that operation is called the join operation. So the join operation is meant to get meaningful information from the cross product. That's the conceptual framework. Let us look at examples of each one and also try to see how a relational algebra operation is mapped as an expression into structured query language. We shall study structured query language in greater details later, but it's just the first introduction. Here is the selection operator. The selection operator is denoted by sigma. You are familiar with the Greek letters. So sigma, there are not many that we shall use. Sigma is the Greek letter that is used to denote selection. The way you write the selection algebra operator is R1 equal to sigma subscript P in bracket R. What does it mean? R is the original relation, say student relation. On that you apply a condition called P, which is a valid condition on R. P is called a predicate. Predicate is the mathematical term. Predicate means condition. So, applying this predicate P to this condition R, you will get a new relation which is denoted by R1. The properties of this selection is that R1 has the same schema as that of R. That is very obvious because you are selecting only rows. And P is any valid condition on R. So if you are putting a condition like hostel number should be equal to 4, that is valid. But height equal to 5 feet 7 inches is not a valid condition, because the condition must be defined in terms of attributes of that particular relation only. Otherwise, it's mathematically invalid. This will permit you to extract any desired conditional information from a single relation. This is a selection that is shown as an example here. R1 is equal to sigma SCPI greater than 9 and SH equal to 3 in bracket student. You all remember the student relation? You all remember that there was a attribute called student hostel, and there was an attribute called performance index. What are you trying to say here? Get me all those students who live in hostel 3 and who have a performance of greater than 9. This relational algebra expression is a complete expression of that desire. Nothing else needs to be stated because the relation schema is already known. In that schema context, I am writing this. The resulting relation in this case, if you go back to the example table that I had shown, you'll get one row because Arul Menezes used to be in hostel 3 in room number 146 and he had a CPI of 9.25. If there were multiple students having CPI greater than this and hostel equal to 3, all of them will come out and they will form the new relation R1. Mathematically, this is very clear. In practice, the clarity is exactly as simple as that. The structured query language of the databases that we are going to study, the SQL query for this relational operation can be written as this. So look at this query. Select star from student where SCPI greater than 9 and SH equal to 3, semicolon. This, by the way, although I have written it in 4 lines, can be written on a single line, and it forms a complete and valid SQL program. Imagine the COBOL program that you will have to write to get the same information out of the same file. What will you do? Describe all the files, all FD entries, then in procedure division open this file, okay, move some high values, low values, or add and something. You set up a iteration, read a file record, then examine. If SH equal to 3 and CPI greater than this, then write this record into another file, go back, at end of file, go down, close file, whatever, blah, blah, blah. Come say come at least a 20, 25 line procedure code and a 30 line FD entry, etc., etc. If you have defined the schema earlier into the relational database, as we shall see, this is the complete SQL program to do the design. The star here means all attributes. We shall see later that star can be replaced by something when we discuss the projection operation. So is the selection operation clear? Select star from this, where this, and this, or this, you can imagine now. Any complex condition can be written here. Here is the projection operation. Projection operation specifies the list of attributes which are to be projected out. So for example, if you have a relation R, the projection operation is denoted by pi, this is the capital pi. So pi list, this is the list of attributes. The resulting relation R1 will now have a new schema. Why? Because I am projecting only a few columns. So original columns were 5, I am projecting 2, the schema will have those 2 column headers as the attributes of this. This has to be a formal relation, R1 has to be a formal relation. That is the requirement of the mathematical structure. What will be the cardinality? Cardinality means number of rows in a table or number of elements in a relation. If I have 5,000 students, there should be 5,000. So number of rows will be exactly same because there is no condition. Well, we shall see that. There is a surprise waiting for us. Consider this first. Project, course name, and course credit from the course. So I just want to know what are the course names and credits that are offered. Okay. This will give me from my sample list, information system 6 credits, data mining 6 credits, professional ethics in IT 3 credits, etc. This will be the output that will come out due to the relational algebra expression if the original relations were this. The corresponding SQL query for this relational algebra expression, you would have guessed, instead of that star which denoted all attributes, now you say select CNAME, comma C credit from course, semicolon. Now you will notice that the characteristic of the statement written earlier for selection operation was the where clause, not the select statement. Curiously, SQL uses select statement for getting any information out of the database. So select statement is used for selection, it is used for projection, used for join, used for cross product, used for everything. The distinction is made by the clauses. The selection is characterized by the where clause, which puts the predicate. The projection is characterized by the list of attributes which is written in the select statement. And there is no predicate here. As we agreed, this list would have course name and course credit, and as everybody says, it will probably have exactly the same number of rows, because I am not reducing the number of rows since I am not putting any condition. But wait, consider this. From the student relation, I project SH, which is the student hostel. The net result is R1. The SQL query for that is select SH from student. No, there are no null values. All hostels are properly written, but there are 5,000 students staying in 13 hostels. So if I get all 5,000 elements of that SH column, same hostel will repeat many times, as many times as there are students sitting there. In a file, I can have multiple values. In a relation, mathematically, I cannot have identical elements, because then it's no more a set. Please remember what I said. A relational operator results in a relation. And that relation must be a mathematically valid relation. Effectively, it means that mathematically valid relation must have a primary key, because then only it is unique, all elements. And if SH is the only column I am projecting, then SH itself must be the primary key of the resulting thing. If SH is the primary key, and if there are exactly 13 hostels in IIT, there cannot be more than 13 elements in the resulting thing. This is a fundamental difference between the relational algebra mathematically interpreted and the SQL query. SQL query, unfortunately, behaves as stupidly as programming languages do. It will produce exactly 5,000 rows, repeating the hostel again and again. If you don't want that, if you want the SQL query to return what is properly a relation, you have to say distinct. Select distinct SH from student. Then it will remove the duplicates. Please note that in programming, removing the duplicate is not as easy as it sounds. It will have to get all the 5,000 rows, sort them, and out of each sorted group, take only one element. So, both ghodagiri karna padega. But if you want that, then there is a separate structure. So, how many elements would R1 have? Here is an example. Projection, if I want to project only SH, then I will have 02, 08, 03, 03, 08. Now, these two jokers belong to the same hostel, and these two belong to the same hostel. As a mathematical relation, I will have 02, 08, 03. That's it. Select distinct SH from student, therefore, the result should be SH 2, 8, and 3, where I have added the word distinct. So, remember, projection operation will always result in a distinct relation. However, SQL, if you say select this comma this comma this from this relation, you may not get only the unique thing, you have to add distinct there. It's a minor. So selection and projection is now very clear. Combination is an expression. This itself is an expression, a relational algebra expression. This is not a mathematical expression in a simple form. It's a relational algebra expression. Sigma SCPI greater than 9 and SH equal to 8 in bracket student. Then the whole thing in bracket, because this whole thing is a relation. Student was a relation. When I apply this selection, I get a relation. And on that relation, I apply the projection, I get only S name. So let's say I am warden of hostel 8 and I just want to know all the brilliant people in my hostel by name. I am not interested in roll number as it is an artificial thing. This query will get me that. This query will first get student roll number, name, hostel number, SPI, room number, whatever, whatever. And then it will project only S name. And as I think all of you would have guessed, the corresponding SQL query will be a combination of a where clause and a list in the select state. So select S name from student where SCPI greater than 9 and SH equal to 8, semicolon. This again is a complete SQL program to extract this information from this data. Do you see the, do you feel the power of the SQL now? And the power comes not out of some ad hoc programming language design. It comes out of a very strong mathematical foundation. A few important things. In the relational algebra, when we put this thing first in inner bracket, and then we put the projection, we are describing to the relational algebra system the sequence in which these operations are to be done. This has to be done first, and then this has to be done. Would it make sense to say pi s name student and then apply a sigma? Why it would make sense? Correct. When I apply pi s name to student, I will get only names. There are two unique names. Now on those names, I cannot apply this condition because that relation, this condition is not valid on that relation. Relational algebra, therefore, is in some sense procedural. It describes the order in which it has to be done. But what about SQL statement? We are nowhere saying, first take me S name or first do me this where clause. And that is the beauty of SQL. SQL is non-procedural. True, to implement this program in real world, the database management system will have to create some procedure. Read file, do this, search this, compare this, whatever what. The beauty is that the database management system takes the responsibility of determining not only what is the correct way of giving you the answer, but also what is the most optimal way. Optimality doesn't enter into consideration here, we shall discuss it later, but the correct way that I must first apply this condition and then only project is automatically understood by the backend database. So is this clear? The projection operation, the expression and the way it is evaluated, and the expression, the way it is translated. Now imagine you don't know anything about relational algebra. You will still feel comfortable in learning about how to extract information from a table given some conditions and given some requirements of projection. So while the mathematical formalism is important, it is not mandatory to be completely understood while using SQL. The reason we are discussing this is to tell you the beauty, and the beauty can be further elaborated in your better understanding. This book contains a whole lot of elaborate mathematical structure. Those of you who are interested can actually look at it in greater details. Now we come to the cross product. The cross product is the fundamental thing which can extract information out of multiple relations. Remember what I said? Selection and projection in combination also apply on one table. But if I have information in student table, information in course table, information in race table, and I want to extract information from multiple tables. In the example that we have been considering, one simple case is I want to get all the courses registered by one student. Then and I want to print the name of the student, hostel number, etc., and all the courses. Now that I cannot get unless I take information from the student table and the race table. Unfortunately, the only mechanism to extract information out of multiple tables is called the cross product. So let's look at the cross product. If there are two relations, R1 and R2, then the cross product is defined by R1 cross R2. Simple multiplication. And multiplication in a relation sense is all elements of this concatenated with each of the elements of the second table forms the cross product. So concatenates each tuple from R1 with every tuple of R2. If there are M and N elements in the two relations, the resultant relation has M into N elements. Chaos. Okay. Imagine if you were to form a cross product of all your policy masters and all your premium transaction records. Mar gaya, you will, cross product will fill up all the available disk in the country. So obviously this is not a very beautiful way of doing things, but mathematically it's the most elegant way of doing things. The schema of R is concatenation of two schemas of R1 and R2. This is the mathematical foundation. So here is an example. Let's take student table and the race table. Student table, I have given an example where I have three rows. There could be multiple rows. These names are not hypothetical, by the way. Muthukrishnan is a renowned professor of computer science in IIT Madras, retired now. Keshav Nori is a great academician working with Tata Consultancy Services. Sunita Saravagi is the youngest trustee on the VLDB trustee committee. She's a colleague of mine. She's a data mining and machine learning expert. So but since all of them were students at some time or the other, I just put them as students. These are the courses which people have registered for. Here again, I have given some sample entries. There are, of course, as I said, there would be about 5,000 students in this table, and there would be about 300 things in this table. So the total will be 5,000 into 300. I can't represent that big table in any presentation here. So I have taken this sample. There are three elements here, and there are five elements here. Totally, how many elements will be there in the cross product? 3 into 5, 15. Okay. Notice that Sunita Saravagi, whose roll number is 5012, has registered for two courses. Keshav Nori has registered for two courses, and Muthu has registered for one course. That's the fact of life. Now let us look at the cross product. If I form a cross product, the cross product will have 15 rows. Again, I have shown some early rows in that, because even 15 I can't fit into this. Notice what is happening. S roll, S name, etc. from the first table, and S roll, C code, etc. from the second table. I have made one distinction here, because there are two S rolls. I have called this reg.S roll, because this S roll comes from the second relation. Correspondingly, I could call this as student.S roll. This, incidentally, is the formal method of distinguishing between the columns of different tables in databases. So this is called prefixing the relation name or the table name. Anyway, notice that first row has 5012, this also has 5012, this has 5012, this has 5012. The third row, however, combines the first row of the first table of Sunita Saravagi with the third row of registration table, which actually belongs to Keshav Nori's registration. But cross product is a dumbo fellow. You know, it's simply concatenate. Now, can you tell me what meaningful information does this row convey to you? Absolutely nothing. Sunita Saravagi's roll number and name, and Muthukrishnan's Keshav Nori's registration. There's no meaning. Obviously, one of the tasks before us is to ensure that such meaningless pieces of information are discarded. We shall see how they can be discarded. But this is the cross product. You all understand this cross product? In this cross product, if you will see, these two rows are important. Why? Because these two rows represent the registration of Sunita Saravagi. How do we infer that? We infer that because in the first attribute S roll, the value is 5012, and in the corresponding attribute extracted from reg, the roll number is same. So that means if the attribute value is same for the common attribute of two tables, then that row is meaningful. As we all have been saying, we are looking for association, relation. And the relation is established because the same roll number here, same roll number there, that is the relation. Everything else is non-relation. So out of this large table of 15 elements, we see these two rows being relevant. We see this row again being irrelevant. Because this row has Keshav Nori's roll number here, and again Keshav Nori's roll number for one registration. So effectively, if there are five elements in the range, then there will be only five meaningful rows in the cross product. There cannot be anything more, right? But I will get 15. How do I extract 5 out of 15? And the trick that we discover is to say that somehow if I can choose only those rows which have the same S roll value here and same S roll value here, I have meaningful information. And that is what you do in a operation beyond the cross product. That operation is called join. In plain English, join means meaningfully joining information from multiple tables. And we have seen what is meaningful. Meaningful is that common attribute value should be same. Correspondingly, the join is defined to get meaningful set of rows from a cross product. And it is defined as R1 cross R2. So fundamentally, the operation of extracting information from two tables is still a cross product. R1 cross R2 forms a relation, which is that big, huge, humongous relation. On that relation, if I apply the selection operation with a row, which is another predicate, this time it is written as a join predicate. That's why it is not written as a P. It is written as row. But you can write it as P as well. It's a predicate, but this predicate is a special predicate. This predicate is not arbitrary condition, this greater than that, that less than this. This predicate has to do with some commonality or relation between the two things so that join is meaningful. There are two types of joins, each providing for meaningful information extraction. One is called a natural join. Natural join is one in which the equality of the common attributes is indicated. And you will all agree that the S role being same on the two sides of the student and reg is the natural relationship, is therefore a natural join. The other join is called a theta join, where the predicate is replaced by theta here. Instead of P or rho, you write a theta, and theta is another predicate. That theta predicate can be a complex condition, but one of the conditions is necessarily some kind of a meaningful join. Otherwise, you will end up getting meaningless. So, is this clear? Now, let's see what happens when we put a join. Natural join ensures equality of values of all common attributes. The resulting schema is the union of two schemas, as the schema of the cross product. But wait, it is union. Union means, in a set union, you remove the common elements. If there are two sets of attributes, when you join them, remember the roll number attribute will appear twice. So you remove one of them, and you say, because it has the common value, no? Natural join means there is no point in having that column, because that column and the first column are exactly identical in the join, not in the cross product. So when you do that, you get a natural join. Natural join is specially denoted in relational algebra by writing a cross product symbol and by putting two vertical bars. So X is cross product, and X preceded and succeeded by a vertical bar is a natural join. So R is equal to student natural join reg is the symbolism. And its meaning in terms of the relational algebra operators is, I first do a cross product student cross reg, and then say sigma student dot role equal to reg dot role. This is the most important condition. It is called the natural join condition. A natural join, in general terms, is far more rigorous than this. If there are three columns which are common on both sides, then equality on each one of those three columns is ensured by natural join. The reason you require theta join is sometimes you want to join on equality of only two or one of those three and put some other condition. Then you call it a theta join. So natural join and theta join are not much different. Okay, you can say natural join is a fundamental strong join, and theta join is a liberated version of that natural join. But the join condition is a requirement. So, student cross reg, I have shown first eight rows, I have shown this, this, and this. In this, we notice that in the natural join, this row will remain, this row will remain, and this row will remain, because they have the same values. These three rows will be extracted in the natural join. The natural join is represented in SQL by simply saying select star from student natural join reg. See how beautiful and concise the SQL command is. Select star from student natural join reg. Earlier, in the early versions of SQL in 1986 and 89, you did not have the natural join as a syntax available in SQL. In those days, you were required to write select star from student comma reg. Student comma reg means a cross product of student and reg. If you put a semicolon here, you'll get those millions of dirty rows. So select star from student comma reg, or select star from x comma y comma z comma t is all cross product in sequence. Where, now this time where is not a ordinary selection condition. It is a selection condition being applied to the cross product, which says student dot s role is equal to reg dot s role. You agree that this is the join condition in this example. This then is a complete SQL program to extract the join of two tables. This is the classical syntax. This is the modern syntax. Yes, sorry. Yeah.
I'm J. Raj, actually. From when this join is available, actually?
Oh, it's available in all SQL implementations now, after 1989. So the current standard, we shall see that 93 standard SQL implements natural join. What happens is, just like COBOL programs, there are some programs in LIC which were developed 20 years ago.
Yeah.
There are some which are being written now. Now you are using Micro Focus COBOL, a certain version. Earlier you were using Softec COBOL, a certain version. COBOL was still same. Many new features have been introduced in COBOL which people today will be using if they are writing new program. But the old programs are still continuing. 80% of the SQL code in the world of old systems will use the second type.
Second only.
It is not necessary to use it at all anymore. So when you migrate, if anybody uses this, I will be very upset. Why are you using this? It is not necessary. Unless you have a theta join, which means you don't want a complete natural join, you want something else.
Okay. Thank you, sir.